हेलो।
बोल। यस
हेलो।
यस
यस, शैल वी वेट फॉर 5 मिनट्स? पार्टिसिपेंट्स आर कमिंग।
ओके, नो प्रॉब्लम, आई कैन वेट।
यस यस यस। अंदर लग सकता है। शैलेंद्र सर,
हाँ बोला।
हेलो। नाशिक नाशिक बार एसोसिएशन आयोजित आज से है 32वां वेबिनार आए। इस वेबिनार में आज के जो वक्ता है उनकी जानकारी और उनको आमंत्रित करने के लिए मैं आमंत्रित करता हूँ हमारे नासिक बार के सचिव जालिंदर जी ताड़गे।
गुड इवनिंग लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, आई वेलकम, फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई वेलकम एडवोकेट श्री सत्यपाल जैन सर, हु हैपन्स टू बी द टॉप लॉयर एंड हु हैज रिप्रेजेंटेड फॉर मेनी इलाइट पर्सनालिटीज लाइक नो अदर देन अवर प्राइम मिनिस्टर श्री नरेंद्र मोदी जी, सुषमा स्वराज, वेंकैया नायडू जी, वाइस प्रेसिडेंट, हु हैपन्स टू बी द वाइस प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ इंडिया, लालकृष्ण आडवाणी जी, एंड मेनी अदर एमपीज, एमएलएज एंड अदर ल्यूमिनियरी। टू स्टार्ट विथ दिस इंट्रोडक्शन, इट इज आई थिंक एंड आई से दैट इट इज माय ग्रेट प्रिविलेज टू इंट्रोड्यूस जैन सर। एज आई सेड अर्लियर, जैन सर हैज बीन द एग्जीक्यूटिव कमिटी मेंबर of National Executive Committee of Bharatiya Janata Party, and to our professional, I proudly say that he is additional Solicitor General of India and also the member of Law Commission of India. Now, having this elite profile, I say that Sir has started his Sir is born from Khurar of Roper district from the Punjab. Then he has completed his BA honors and MA in political science. Thereafter, in the year 1979, he has completed his legal education from Dow College of Dehradun. Sir had always been into the public life, and accordingly he has started his public life right from college. He had been the Senate member, he had represented the university. Thereafter, the most precisely, I say, he has participated in the movement led by late Jayaprakash Narayan during emergency period of 1974 to 76. He even had been to the jail in lieu of that movement, and thereafter he had been also he had started his practice. Now, after starting with the practice, he had been to the legal profession. He has taken up all the legal, political, and other challenges. I say that he has worked as the active member of RSS. Then he had been active in Vidyarthi Parishad of BJP, and thereafter, since long, he has been the political backbone of Bharatiya Janata Party. I say he had represented Chandigarh Lok Sabha constituency in the 11th and 12th Lok Sabha, and that is actually in 1996 and 1998. He worked on many prestigious committees, and thereafter, now he is working as additional Solicitor General of India. Also, he is prestigiously representing as the member of National Law Commission. So I say to the members of our fraternity that we have been privileged to have sir amongst us for this purpose and to deliver the lecture on the issue of law of election. Moreover, all of us or many of us have represented in election matters, but I say that sir has represented candidates or candidates who had filed nomination for respected election of Vice President and President of India, that is Mr. Bhairav Singh Shekhawat, Mrs. Najma Hepatullah, and Mr. P.A. Sangmaji. So I am really privileged to introduce sir. Sir, Nasik Bar Association is one of the prestigious bar association in Maharashtra and actively takes part in all the activities. We have among 3,800 members per bar and around 400 members are from the Nasik district. So, that members will join sooner or later. But having the situation of Nisarga tornado around the area, it may have affected the attendance. But I hope they will attend soon. And I request Sharadji that kindly begin with the lecture. I request sir to begin with the lecture. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Jalendra Tagde. And I am really grateful to the office bearers, all the members of the Nasik Bar Association for inviting me to discuss with you the various aspects of the election laws in India. I have heard a lot about the Nasik Bar Association, and perhaps this may be my first interaction with very learned and honorable members of the Nasik Bar Association. Some of the faces I am watching, I have already seen them, met them, but still I am very grateful to all of you for having invited me to deliver this so-called lecture or talk on the election law before very learned members of the Bar Association. See, India is a democratic country. We are a sovereign country, and our constitution provides for elections right from the office of the panch to the president of India. Right from the panch, the panchas, sarpanchas, municipalities, district level, jila parishad, panchayat samitis, municipalities, then the assemblies. In certain states like Maharashtra, there are two chambers, the legislative assembly and the legislative council. And in parliament, of course, we have two houses, the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha. And then highest of all, the highest constitutional offices of the President of India and the Vice President of India. So under the Constitution of India, there is a three-tier election procedure which has been prescribed. So far as the elections to panchas, sarpanchas,
municipalities, municipal corporations, Jila Parishad, Panchayat Samiti, which we call as the local self-government department. They are concerned in the entire country, the elections to these institutions are conducted by the state-made laws. Somewhere it is Maharashtra Municipal Act, Haryana Municipal Act, Punjab Municipal Act, Municipal Corporation Act, Gram Panchayat Act, Jila Parishad Act, and these elections are conducted now by the state election commissions. Every state now has its own state election commission, which consists of some retired members. There is a procedure prescribed for constituting those state election commissions. So the elections, panch, sarpanch, municipal corporation, municipal committee, the Jila Parishad, Panchayat Samiti, etc., etc. And in Maharashtra, it may be even the cooperative societies also, because you have a very strong cooperative movement in Maharashtra. They are conducted by the state election commission. Now the next step is the election to the Vidhan Sabha, to the Vidhan Parishad, Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha. These elections are conducted by the Election Commission of India as prescribed by the Constitution. And the third stage, final election, then the legislature both at the national level and the state level, and the highest two constitutional officers, the president and vice president, they are also conducted by the Election Commission. I will come to that act a little later. See, when we discuss the election law in India, we have to basically start from Article 324 of the Constitution of India. The Article 324 of the Constitution of India gives power to the Election Commission of India to conduct election, to hold election, to Vidhan Sabhas, Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, the President of India and the Vice President of India. 324 gives this power to the Election Commission of India to hold these elections. And so far as the local body elections are concerned, after the 73rd Amendment in the Constitution of India, Article 243K, this deals with the elections to the panchayats, Panchayat Samiti, Jila Parishad, etc. And Article 243ZA, it deals with the elections to the municipalities. So these are the two articles which were inserted after the 73rd Amendment, which gave power to the State Election Commission to conduct the elections. All other elections are conducted by the Election Commission of India. This article read with Article 329. So you have to basically read three articles, 243K and ZA, 324 and then 329. The elections are conducted by the Election Commission. Powers of delimitation, powers of preparing electoral rolls, powers of revising the electoral rolls, that has also been given under Article 324, 329 to the Election Commission of India. And Article 329A puts a bar that the finality of the delimitation, electoral rolls, etc., that is final, and it cannot be called in question in any court of law. Courts cannot interfere in that. And from the lawyer's point of view, another clause, Article 329B, this is very important from the lawyer's point of view, from the election point of view. This constitutional provision says that no election to either any Vidhan Sabha, Vidhan Parishad, Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, or to the highest officers, it cannot be challenged except by way of the procedure prescribed by Parliament. Or in other words, it cannot be challenged except by an election petition. Now, exercising powers under Article 329B, the Parliament of India has enacted two acts. It has provided for two acts. They are called as, first, the Representation of People Act 1950, लोक प्रतिनिधित्व अधिनियम 1950, और दूसरा है the Representation of People Act 1951, लोक प्रतिनिधित्व अधिनियम 1951. The name of both the acts is the same, but the scope of both the acts are entirely different. So far as the first act, the Representation of People Act 1950 is concerned, it deals with the preparation of the electoral rolls, modification of the electoral rolls, deletion of the names of the persons from the electoral list, addition of the names of the people in the voter list. This act only deals with that. And under this act, the registration of electoral rules, the registration of electoral rules have been framed under this act, which prescribe a complete procedure for the registration of the voters, or we call as the preparation of the voter list. Now, who is entitled to be registered as a voter? As per this act, as per the latest amendments, if you are 18 years of age on the 1st of January, when you in the year in which you want to be enrolled as an elector, then you have to apply to the electoral officers, fill a form, apply, and then you apply for becoming a voter in the voter list. The Election Commission is also expected and obliged under the act to revise the voter list every year, keeping 1st of January as the date of eligibility. Now, because we are all advocates, though you are entitled to be registered as a voter at the age of 18 years, but practically this 18 years period gets extended by the month in which you are born. For example, if you are born in December in a particular year, so you will be deemed to be the 18 years of age on the next year, and meaning thereby 18 plus 10 or 12 months more will be added to enable you to become a voter in the constituency. Number two, there is a detailed procedure prescribed. You can apply for being enrolled as a voter. If you feel that no, some people have been enrolled as voter, they are not entitled to, you can object to that. The Election Commission cannot delete any name of any voter without giving him a notice. And you can apply for being enrolled as a voter even during the revision also. And otherwise, there's a form 6 under the Registration of Electoral Rules, which you can fill and you for being. But if you are, your claim is rejected, you can go in appeal to the chief electoral officer, to the other people. But once the electoral rolls are published, let us be very clear about it, then the voter list is final. This voter list, the finality of the voter list cannot be challenged in any court of law. Once you have been registered as a voter, even if you have left that place, even if you were not qualified on the date to be registered as a voter, but wrongly, by mistake or by mischief, you have been enrolled as a voter, then as per law, you are entitled to cast your vote on the date of polling. Any person whose name finds mention in the electoral roll is entitled to cast his vote on the date of polling. And if it is not entered, you may be residing at that place for 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, then you can't vote on the date of polling. This is a very important aspect of the election law, because we find on the date of polling, hundreds of people come saying that, look here, I have got the photo identity card with me, voter identity card with me, but my name is not in the voter list. Can I cast my vote? No. You can cast your vote only, you drive your right to cast your vote only and only if your name finds mention in the electoral roll, which is published prior to the holding of the election. And second, during the process of election, issuance of the notification and till the polling is over, neither any voter can be added nor any voter can be deleted. Voter list will remain the same as on the date of publication till the counting is done, till the result. So therefore, these are the a few aspects about the preparation of electoral roll, which just I wanted to bring to your kind notice. Now, the another thing is the election. Actual election, we call it in the simple word. This election of MLAs and MPs is governed by the Representation of People Act 1951. And there are certain rules have been framed under this act. They are called as conduct of election rules for the proper smooth conducting of the elections. Detailed procedure has been prescribed in this act and in these rules for the smooth conduct of the elections. Now, the question is, first, who can contest election? What are the eligibilities? The disqualifications and the conditions are prescribed in Article 102 of the Constitution of India for MPs and Article 191 of the Constitution for the MLAs, state legislatures. In addition to that, the Representation of People Act deals with the qualifications of the people who can contest election. These are the article sections of the Representation of People Act 1951. Section 3 to Section 11B deals with the disqualification. Some of them are very glaring. I like to bring to your notice. Number one, if any person is convicted of any criminal offense for 2 or more than 2 years, he is disqualified from contesting election. Not only for 2 years, for 6 years after he is relieved from the jail.
Hello. Am I audible? Hello.
Network. Yes, yes.
Sir. Am I audible?
Yes, yes sir. Please.
Now, there must be some technical problems today. It was apprehended. Now,
yes.
So, far as the filing, I have said that there are the qualification discussion. I don't know. The filing of nomination and scrutiny is a very important stage in the election. The legislature has prescribed a complete pro forma, which you have to fill when you file your nomination. An independent candidate can be proposed by 10 electors, has to be proposed by 10 electors, but a candidate set up by a political party, he can be proposed only by one voter. This was done with an intention that not a large number of independent candidates come in the election. They are not serious. So just to bring seriousness, it was decided that independents must be proposed by at least 10 voters. Now, during the last 10, 20 years, the nomination has become very complicated form. It has become very complicated. Along with the nomination form, you have to give complete information about yourself, your spouse, and your dependent children. The property that you own, movable, immovable, total complete criminal record, whether any case is pending against you, whether you have been convicted, whether any trial is going on. And in short, if I may say that, the Supreme Court, by way of various judgments, has taken it to this extent that in case you suppress a fact from the affidavit or you don't give the information, keep it blank, the returning officer has the power to reject your nomination paper. Intention is that every candidate should give all details about himself to the public and to the electorate so that the people know who is the candidate, what is his background, how much properties is he having, how much he is qualified, and not only the qualification, the candidate is supposed to mention even the name of the institution. You passed your BA, from where did you pass it, which year, which university, what was the roll number, what was the result. All those informations are now required to be given in the affidavit. Now, sir, the second comes the scrutiny. Under Section 36 of the RPA Act, the returning officer has the power to reject the nomination paper of a candidate if it is not in form, if he is not qualified on that day, if he has not filled form as per law. This also, first nomination. Second is the scrutiny. This is also a very important stage in the election. The returning officer, as per Section 36, of course, cannot reject a nomination on a ground which is not very substantial in nature. And he has to ignore typographical mistakes in the nomination. For example, somebody's name is Ram Lal. In the voter list, it is only published Ram, or it is only published Lal. And there is no dispute that the person is the same. Then he will ignore this typographical mistake. There is a spelling mistake. But if there is a substantial defect in the nomination form, the returning officer has the power to reject that nomination form. I give you an example here. Chaudhary Charan Singh remained the Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh. He remained the Prime Minister of India. And after, in 1980, after he remained the Prime Minister of India, to contest for Lok Sabha. Unfortunately, in his nomination form, he forgot to mention the age in the column of age. It was left blank. Nobody could dispute the age of Chaudhary Charan Singh. He had crossed the stage. He had remained the Chief Minister, the Prime Minister, and all that. Still, the returning officer said that since it is a substantial defect, you have not filled the age in your form, his nomination paper was rejected. Now, the returning officer has the power to accept or reject the nomination paper. But as a lawyer, we should remember one thing more also. Once the returning officer has either accepted it or rejected it, he cannot review his own decision. That is final. Neither can the election commission give direction to the returning officer that, look here, you have wrongly accepted a nomination or you have wrongly rejected a nomination. No. The decision of the returning officer is final. And the only remedy against that, whether it is illegally accepted or it is illegally rejected, lies in an election petition, which you have to file after the election is over. Now, sir, the election polling, etc. I'm not going into detail all those things. The polling is done nowadays by the voting electronic machines. Number of doubts were raised by many people. Sometime by this party, sometime by that party. But now, and not only as a member of the BJP, but I am saying even as a responsible citizen of this country, it is beyond the scope of any interference with the voting electronic machines. Nobody can tamper them. Nobody can change them. And it is these voting machines which have yielded different results in different states. Now the voting machines are, voting is done after.
And after the voting, then counting takes place, result is declared. In the election law, the only remedy to challenge an election is the election petition, which has to be filed after the election is declared. Now, under section 100 and section 101 of the RPA Act 1951, it gives various grounds for setting aside the election of any returned candidate. You have to go through that. You have not, what are the grounds? The nomination papers have not been legally accepted or legally rejected. You were not qualified on the date of election. You were not duly elected. You have resorted to corrupt practices. These are the all grounds set out in section 100 and 101 of the Representation of People Act 1951. Now, section 80, 81, 82, 83, 84, 85, 86. 80 to 86 are the sections of the RPA Act, which deals with the trial of the election petition in the High Court. These are very important. Very important. Because election law is a technical law. You have to do the things as required by law. For example, under Section 81, 82, 83, you have to implead the persons only visualized by that section as respondents. You have to give all material facts in the election petition. You have to supply a complete copy of the election petition to the other party. If the copy given through the returned candidate is not a true copy of the election petition as placed on the record of the High Court, then this is a ground where the election petition can be dismissed in limine. The limitation of 45 days is prescribed for filing an election petition. Suppose you filed it after that, the Limitation Act is not applicable to the election law and it can be dismissed on the ground of being time barred. True copy, time barred, parties. And the fourth very important aspect is you have to plead all material facts in the election petition. If you miss even a single material fact in the election petition, the Supreme Court says it is sufficient to dismiss your election petition even at the threshold. I'll request my lawyer brothers to start from reading two judgments, AIR 1986 and AIR 1987, Azhar Hussain versus late Shri Rajiv Gandhi, and Dharti Pakad Madan Lal versus the late Shri Rajiv Gandhi. These two judgments deal in detail with the requirement of a valid and a proper election petition. And there are hundreds of judgments after that where the election petitions have been dismissed primarily on the ground that it did not comply with the requirement of law. Now, the CPC is applicable to the election law. Evidence Act is also applicable, but it has its own procedure. Sir, there are 10 corrupt practices which are prohibited by the law under the RP Act. Why? Because the intention is that all candidates should not resort, any candidate should not resort to unfair means in winning election. If you commit any of the corrupt practices, even if the candidate has won the election by a margin of 1 lakh vote, 2 lakh vote, 3 lakh votes, your election is liable to be set aside and you are liable to be disqualified for 6 years from contesting election. And these are the 10 corrupt practices we call as Bhrasht Acharan, which have been visualized by the RPA Act 1951. Number one, bribery, undue influence, appeal in the name of religion, appeal to promote hatred between different communities, propagation of sati. If any candidate said, yes, I will go for the Pratap Sati, I appreciate that. It is a disqualification under the RP Act. Personal character assassination of the other candidate. You can criticize the policies, but you cannot criticize the personal conduct of a person in the elections. Then hiring of vehicles. Though every candidate does it because it doesn't come on record. But as per law, on the date of polling, no candidate can take the voters in his vehicles to the polling booth. You cannot provide for the vehicles for taking to the polling booth. Do it, you are disqualified from contesting election. Then incurring more expenditure. Now, the Election Commission prescribes a limit for all Vidhan Sabha elections and Lok Sabha elections. It differs from state to state. That in assembly election, for example, I give an example, Maharashtra. That in Maharashtra assembly election, no candidate can spend more than, I give an example, twice. Some state will be 10 lakhs. Some state it will be 15 lakhs. Lok Sabha it may be different, depending upon the population area of that concerned area. This is decided by the Election Commission. Suppose not to spend more than 10 lakhs in your election, even a 1 rupee more than that, it's a corrupt practice. Your election can be set aside, you can be disqualified. Taking personal assistance from public servants and gazetted officers. Now, sir, if you take the assistance government officer, gazetted officer, police officer, revenue officer in the election, you take him along with you for canvassing, you ask him to ring up people and say, please, I am an excise officer here. Please vote for Mr. So-and-so, so-and-so. This is a corrupt practice. If it is proved on record, you will be disqualified. And the last now corrupt practice, which was added after the certain incidents of booth capturing claim in Indian politics. Now, if you capture the booth on the day of polling, it is also a corrupt practice. What does it mean by booth capturing? Booth capturing means polling is going on. A candidate takes four muscle men, or whatever word you may use for him, to the polling booth, doesn't allow any other person to enter the polling booth except his own people, or they take possession of the voting machine, tick, 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 do all the formalities and cast the bogus votes. If you commit a corrupt practice of booth capturing, it is proved that you have done booth capturing, your election can be set aside and you can be disqualified for 6 years from contesting the race. These are the disqualifications which have been prescribed under the Act. I give an example to them. Suppose I'm contesting election. I'm a Jain. I go to ask the voters for vote. I say, look here, I belong to BJP or Congress or Akali Dal, wherever any candidate belonging to any political party. Please vote for me. Okay, no problem. You confess your point of view also, the agenda, the propaganda, the manifesto of your party. I belong to BJP, I will say I am a BJP man. But any person belonging to any political party will say that. Then there is no problem. But if you say that, look here, since I am a Jain, you are also a Jain. Or I am a Muslim, you are also a Muslim. Or I am a Christian, you are also a Christian. Or I am a Rajput, whatever it is, the caste, region, religion, language and all that. If I seek vote on the name of caste, religion, race, then it is a disqualification under the Act. If you seek votes by putting pressure, that look here, if you don't for me, I will oppose you in that particular thing. You will be removed from there. I will get you removed from the office of that person, particular office. It's undue influence. If you offer him that if you vote for me, I'll give you this good pen, which I have got from somebody. I'll give you this amount. I will give you this gift. It's a corrupt practice of bribery. So these are the 10 corrupt practices which have been prohibited under the law from enabling a candidate not to contest. Now, sir, under the RPA Act, Section 86, it prescribes a limit of 6 months for deciding the election petitions. 6 months. But we have seen, the whole experience shows that sometimes they are not decided even within 6 years. Because the procedure is very cumbersome. It's a very long procedure. It takes a lot of time in the trial of the election petitions. It takes a lot of time for deciding the petition, but the law requires decide within 6 months. Now, sir, one thing I would like to add here by all my colleagues. Earlier, we used to go for the voting on the polling booths. Polling booth will be set up. All candidates set up their tents outside the polling booth. Agent of every candidate will be sitting within the polling booth. The polling booth will have 4 or 5 people from the election department also. Outside the polling booth, there will be tents of all the political parties where every time almost 20-25 people of every political party, every candidate are present there. And all candidates, maybe of parties or independent, are entitled to have their tents outside the polling booth. Now, in view of this corona, where social distancing is a must, where 2 gaj ki duri hai bahut zaruri, this has posed serious legal questions before the legal fraternity, before the election commission also, before the election political parties also. Now, we may have to resort to shift to other mode of voting other than the voting going to the polling booth and casting your vote. Either it may be a polling booth, mobile polling booth, going to the areas, getting people to vote there in that booth, or voting online, provide the online, let the voting take place from your own residence, then you have to ensure the secrecy also. But this has thrown a very important legal issue in the legal field Now you must have seen the Rajya Sabha elections, which were to take place on 26th of March. Because of the Corona, Election Commission had to postpone them. Now the polling will take on 19th of June. Election Commission will have to prescribe how people will enter one by one, how much distance will they maintain, how the pen will be prescribed, how will they sign the register with the same pen, how will they mark the vote with the same pen. These are the issues which, in view of the Corona, will have to be examined and taken a fresh decision by the Election Commission. Now, these are the basic things which I brought to your notice about the election to MPs, MLAs and all that. Now, there is an election to the office of President and Vice President. This is election conducted under the presidential election of the Presidential and Vice Presidential Election Act. It deals with the election of the President and the Vice President. The President of India is elected by the elected members of both the Houses of Parliament and both the MLAs of each and every state. It's a huge electoral college. There are about 5,500 MLAs in the entire country and about 880 MPs in the parliament. So the MLAs and the MPs put together elect the President of India. So two things are very important in this election. Anti-defection law, 10th schedule, was inserted in the constitution. But this anti-defection law, please keep in mind, the anti-defection law is not applicable to the election to the President of India, to the Vice President of India, and to the Rajya Sabha. Of course, in the election to Rajya Sabha, a member of a political party is supposed to show his ballot paper to the authorized representative of his party, but still it has to be secret. He cannot show it to anybody else other than the authorized representative. Independent has not to show it to any person. So number one, secrecy has to be maintained. Number two, even if those who are showing it, anti-defection law is not applicable. In the election of the President, Vice President and Rajya Sabha, you cannot issue a whip. No party can issue a whip that in case you do not follow the whip of the party, you will be disqualified. No, it cannot be. The intention was that the people may exercise their vote for the electing the highest constitutional authority as per their constitution. Now, this is very important. And so far as the election of the President and Vice President is concerned, the election petition under this act goes to the 5 judges bench of the Supreme Court of India. If you go through the law, almost all the elections except the last one or two have been challenged in the Supreme Court of India. It was the election of Gyani Jal Singh ji also, Shri Neelam Sanjeeva Reddy also, Shri Pranab Mukherjee also, and Sanjeeva Reddy also, Shri K.R. Narayanan also. It is the 5 judges bench of the Constitution bench of the Supreme Court which hears the election petition against the President and the Vice President. And almost every election the dispute has gone, but it is different from the dispute under the RPA. So the disqualifications, the corrupt practices, by and large, the same. So I will like to conclude by saying that Indian system, 3-tier system election, we have adopted local bodies to be conducted by the state election commissions, Vidhan Sabha, Lok Sabha, and the President and Vice President to be conducted by the Election Commission of India, which is an autonomous institution, which is not under any government. And the remedy to challenge an election is only by way of an election petition in the High Court or in the Supreme Court as per the provisions of the law. Right from 1952 Purnu Swami's case till 78 Mahinder Singh Gill's case, and now there are a number of judgments where the honorable courts have held in a number of cases that the only remedy is the election petition of India as per law. I think I have given you, because it's a very, very technical subject. It's a technical law. It's a very comprehensive law. All provisions are prescribed and they are visualized by the act. It's a special act. Things have to be done as required by law. There's no question of principle of equity, fair play, or balance of convenience. Each thing to be done as required by law. Filing of nomination paper. A time is fixed. You can file it between 11 to 3. And
if last day 3 p.m. is the time, if you file right up to 3 p.m., it is valid. But if it is late even by 1 second, by 1 minute, your nomination is liable to be rejected. There is no limitation act applicable to election law, no concession given. Things have to be done as required by law. And I think I have given you a bird's eye view of the election laws, both RP Act and the Presidential Elect also. And I'd like to welcome, if you want any clarification, any question, it will be most welcome. It will be my privilege to reply to all your inquiries. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Dadi, sir.
Ji. सर बहुत बड़ा धन्यवाद. बहुत ही अच्छी तरह से आपने हमारे जो मित्र है उनको ये आपने लॉ ऑफ इलेक्शन के बारे में समझाया है और आपका जो अथॉरिटी है वो भी बहुत ही अच्छी तरह से प्रतीत होता है. तो हमारा ये सौभाग्य है कि आज हम आपको सुन सके. तो अपने एक कोऑर्डिनेटर है, अपने सहकारी है नीलकंठ से आए, वो पूछना चाहते है कि कैन वी चैलेंज द ऑर्डर्स ऑफ आरओ एंड व्हाट आर द पावर्स ऑफ आरओ रिटर्निंग ऑफिसर.
Yes, see, the returning officer has two very important powers under the RPA Act, Representation of People Act. First, it is he who is the final authority under Section 36 to decide the validity or invalidity of the nomination paper. Under Section 36, this power has been given to the RO. He is the final authority. And his order can be challenged only by way of an election petition. Neither the Election Commission of India has any power to set aside his election, his decision, nor even the courts at the intermediate stage. His authority, even he cannot review his own order. Suppose he accepts a nomination paper, he signs it, accept it, and he later on he finds that no, I have committed a mistake. He becomes functus officio, he cannot do anything. This can be challenged only by way of an election petition. After the election is over, you go from Punnuswamy 1952, Mahinder Singh Gill versus the Election Commission 1978, and many other judgments also. Second exclusive power of the returning officer is to decide about the validity or invalidity of a vote. It is his exclusive power. For example, in the Rajya Sabha elections, an MLA goes to cast his vote. He is not supposed to show his ballot paper to any other person except the authorized representative of his political party. But if he shows it to somebody else, he violates the secrecy. Then the returning officer can immediately decide that no, your vote will be invalid. Or even at the time of counting, because Rajya Sabha election, presidential election is by way of the ballot. And he finds that secrecy has been violated, the returning officer has every right to accept or reject a particular ballot paper, which we call as the vote. The decision is final. You must have seen in the case of Gujarat, when Mr. Ahmed Patel was elected, Mr. Amit Shah and Srimati Samriti Rani were the candidates. The Election Commission gave a direction to the electoral office, the returning officer, to reject two ballot papers. That is under challenge. And one of the grounds is that the final power of the RO cannot be interfered with by the Election Commission of India. So these are the two powers of the RO which can be challenged only by way of an election petition and not by way of a writ petition.
धन्यवाद सर. उसके बारे में जो returning officer से उसके power से तो जो lacuna और defect of substantial nature अभी form number 26A आने के बाद 26A तो वो सिचुएशन बहुत ही ड्रास्टिकली चेंज हो गई. समझो एक आध प्रॉपर्टी का डिटेल रह गया, एक आधा गुना रह गया या कोई अलग डिटेल रह गया. तो हमने तो एक केस ऐसा भी रिप्रेजेंट किया था एमएलसी इलेक्शन में कि जो इरिलेवेंट कॉलम्स है जो अपना चिल्ड्रेन वाले तो उसमें एक कॉलम छपा नहीं था इसलिए भी वो चैलेंज हो गया था. तो दिस इज मेकिंग राउंड्स इन द स्क्रूटनी प्रोसेसेस. So, what is your opinion regarding the substantial nature of this defect or form number 26A?
See, now this form 26A, etc. have come primarily because of the judgments of the Supreme Court. and Supreme Court has enhanced it to this extent that in case you leave certain columns in the affidavit blank, मान लीजिए आपके खिलाफ कोई आपका कॉलम है, क्या आपको किसी क्रिमिनल कोर्ट ने कन्विक्ट किया है?
जी.
नहीं किया तो लिख दीजिए नो, पर अगर आप उसको ब्लैंक छोड़ते हो तो उनका ये कहना है ये सब्सटेंशियल डिफेक्ट है. आपकी प्रॉपर्टीज कोई है, आप पर केस चल रहे हैं, आप उसका जिक्र कर दीजिए कि हाँ ये मेरे खिलाफ केस है, ये वहां पर चल रहा है. लेकिन अगर आप नहीं करते हैं तो इसका मतलब है आप इंफॉर्मेशन कंसील कर रहे हैं. आपकी एजुकेशनल क्वालिफिकेशन है, मान लो आपने एमए की है, आप लिखिए मैंने एमए पास किया है, बीए किया है, बीएड किया है, इस यूनिवर्सिटी से किया, इस साल से किया. सुप्रीम कोर्ट ये कह रहा है कि अगर आपने कॉलम को ब्लैंक छोड़ा है तो ये कंसीलमेंट है और सेक्शन 36 में ये सब्सटेंशियल डिफेक्ट है, नॉमिनेशन रिजेक्ट हो सकता है. पर यदि आपने इंफॉर्मेशन दी है और उसको डिस्प्यूट किया जा रहा है कि इंफॉर्मेशन सही नहीं है, तब ये विषय रिटर्निंग ऑफिसर की इंक्वायरी करने का नहीं है कि आपकी इंफॉर्मेशन सही है या गलत है. इसलिए अब जो कहा जा रहा है कोई भी कॉलम ब्लैंक मत छोड़िए, हाँ या ना जो भी सही जानकारी आपके पास है वो भरिए. दूसरा जो सब्सटेंशियल डिफेक्ट और नॉर्मल डिफेक्ट में बात आती है वो आती है, मान लीजिए मैंने जैसे कहा कि आपका नाम यज्ञ दत्त शर्मा है, मैं एग्जाम्पल दे रहा हूं, और मान लीजिए वहां जग छप गया, जग दत्त शर्मा छप गया, मान लीजिए वहां जग शर्मा छप गया, इससे कोई मटेरियल इफेक्ट नहीं होता है. मान लीजिए आपका वोटर लिस्ट में नंबर 324 है, आपने बाय मिस्टेक 824 मेंशन कर दिया है, लेकिन वोटर लिस्ट आपके पास है, आप रिटर्निंग ऑफिसर को दिखा रहे हो कि देखिए ये मेरा वोटर नंबर है, गलती से 324 आ गया, बट आई एम ए वोटर, सो लॉन्ग यू आर ए वोटर, सो इट इज नॉट ए सब्सटेंशियल डिफेक्ट. बट इफ यू आर नॉट ए वोटर, यू आर नॉट ए वोटर, यू हैव मेंशनड ए रॉन्ग नंबर, देन इट इज ए क्वेश्चन ऑफ सब्सटेंशियल डिफेक्ट. तो ये सारी चीजें उस पर आती है. इसमें भी एक राइट कैंडिडेट को दिया है लॉ ने, अगर आपके नॉमिनेशन पर कोई ऑब्जेक्शन सडनली हो जाता है और आपको लगता है कि आप स्क्रूटनी के टाइम डॉक्यूमेंट्स लेकर नहीं आए हैं, तो आप रिटर्निंग ऑफिसर को रिक्वेस्ट कर सकते हैं कि मुझे एक दिन का टाइम दिया जाए, और रिटर्निंग ऑफिसर सेक्शन 36 सब सेक्शन 4, ही इज बाउंड बाय लॉ टू अडजर्न द स्क्रूटनी टू द नेक्स्ट डेट, मैक्सिमम नेक्स्ट डेट. शाम तक का टाइम दे सकता है, दोपहर तक का टाइम दे सकता है, अगले दिन का, उससे ज्यादा टाइम वो नहीं दे सकता. इसलिए अगर कहीं ऐसी नौबत आती है तो जानकारी लीजिए. और ये जो पॉलिटिकल पार्टी के कैंडिडेट्स हैं, इनको फॉर्म ए एंड बी भरना पड़ता है ताकि वो अपनी पॉलिटिकल पार्टी का सिंबल क्लेम कर सके. अब ये फॉर्म ओरिजिनल में जाना हो, फैक्स से नहीं जा सकता, फोटोकॉपी नहीं जा सकती, इसको इंक से साइन होना चाहिए, ये बॉल पेन से साइन होकर नहीं जा सकता. आपको याद होगा, आपने इससे सुना होगा, 2009 के इलेक्शन में श्रीमती सुषमा स्वराज विदिशा से इलेक्शन लड़ी थी, उनके अगेंस्ट जो कांग्रेस के कैंडिडेट थे उन्होंने फॉर्म ए और बी ओरिजिनल की बजाय फोटोकॉपी लगा दी थी. अब क्योंकि वो फोटोकॉपी थी जो लॉ में परमिसिबल नहीं है और वो सब्सटेंशियल डिफेक्ट था, तो उनको नॉमिनेशन रिजेक्ट हो गया. उन्होंने इलेक्शन पिटीशन भी डाली लेकिन उसके में कुछ निकला. तो ये रिटर्निंग ऑफिसर की जो पावर है ये सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने बहुत एक्सटेंड की है.
धन्यवाद सर. अगला सवाल जो है, जो अभी करप्ट प्रैक्टिस के 210 जो प्रोविजन है आपने बताए, लेकिन अभी जो चेंजिंग सिनेरियो है, हम जो जिस वर्ल्ड में अभी रह रहे हैं, तो जो आईटी का युग है, इसमें जो माध्यम है, व्हाट्सएप हो, इंस्टा हो या फेसबुक हो या न्यूज चैनल के मार्फत जो प्रचार किया जाता है, जिस तरह से प्रसार किया जाता है, तो वो करप्ट प्रैक्टिस में कैंडिडेट हो या वो पक्ष हो, तो उसका क्या चेंज आना चाहिए, क्या तरतूद होनी चाहिए या सही है?
देखिए, लॉ में जो करप्ट प्रैक्टिस है वो कैंडिडेट या उसका इलेक्शन एजेंट या कोई व्यक्ति जिसको कैंडिडेट ने ऑथराइज किया है, इन तीन कैटेगरीज में अगर इन्होंने कोई भी लॉ की वायलेशन की है तो उसका लिए कैंडिडेट रिस्पॉन्सिबल है. अगर उसके अलावा कुछ लोग और करते हैं तो फिर ये कैंडिडेट की करप्ट प्रैक्टिस नहीं हो सकता. इसे सोशल मीडिया में अगर कैंडिडेट कोई कमेंट्स पास करता है, कैंडिडेट का इलेक्शन एजेंट करता है या कोई और पर्सन विद द कंसेंट ऑफ द कैंडिडेट करता है, तो वो करप्ट प्रैक्टिस माना जाएगा. मान लीजिए आप सोशल मीडिया में किसी को ऑफर करते हो, आप प्रचार करते हो पर्टिकुलर एक रिलीजन के लोगों को कि ऑल मुस्लिम्स और ऑल हिंदूज और ऑल सिख शुड वोट फॉर ए पर्टिकुलर कैंडिडेट. इफ इट इज डन एदर बाय द कैंडिडेट or his election agent or by any person with the consent of the candidate, then it is a corrupt practice. But if others are doing, then it is an offense. They can be prosecuted under the separate provisions, but candidate cannot be made liable for that.
Yes, sir. और एक सवाल है, अभी एक सवाल आया है, तो थोड़ी कुछ दिनों पहले हमारे जो महाराष्ट्र के मुख्यमंत्री जी है, उनका जो हाउस ऑफ असेंबली लेजिस्लेटिव असेंबली पे उनका जो इलेक्शन करना था, 6 महीने के अंदर आना था चुन के, तो जो उसका जो प्रोसीजर है आर्टिकल 164(1)(4) और उसके बारे में बहुत यहाँ चर्चा हुई है। माननीय राज्यपाल महोदय जो है उनकी भूमिका ये बहुत चर्चित हुई थी, तो व्हाट आर द पावर्स एंड प्रोसीजर्स रिगार्डिंग द इलेक्शन नॉमिनेशन और व्हाट आर द पावर्स ऑफ गवर्नर?
देखिए, महाराष्ट्र में जो केस आया है, इससे पहले पंजाब में भी ऐसा केस हुआ था। कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन के अनुसार, एज पर द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन ऑफ इंडिया, कोई भी एमएलए एमपी ना होते हुए मंत्री बन सकता है 6 महीने के लिए, और अगर 6 महीने में वो किसी भी हाउस का मेंबर नहीं बनता तो उसकी मंत्रिपरिषद, चाहे वो मुख्यमंत्री है चाहे मंत्री है, वो स्वतः समाप्त हो जाती है। महाराष्ट्र के मुख्यमंत्री क्योंकि विधायक नहीं थे और विधान परिषद के भी सदस्य नहीं थे, इसलिए अगर वो 27 मई तक दोनों सदनों में से किसी के भी सदस्य नहीं बनते तो उनके मुख्यमंत्री पद स्वयं 27 मई को शाम को 11:60 पर समाप्त हो जाते। कई बार कुछ मंत्री मुख्यमंत्री क्या करते थे, किसी व्यक्ति को जो एमपी एमएलए नहीं है उसको मंत्री बना दिया, 6 महीने के बाद रिजाइन लेके 2 दिन के बाद फिर दोबारा मंत्री बना दिया, फिर 6 महीने आगे निकल गए, ऐसे करके बहुत समय निकाल देते थे। लेकिन सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने आगे चलकर कहा कि ये प्रावधान सिर्फ और सिर्फ एक बार एक्सेप्शन है, इसको आप आगे नहीं ले जा सकते। अगर 6 महीने में वो व्यक्ति सदस्य नहीं बनता तो उसकी मंत्रिपरिषद और जो भी समाप्त हो जाए। तो इस हिसाब से अगर श्री उद्धव ठाकरे जी 27 मई तक किसी सदन के भी सदस्य ना बनते तो उनकी सदस्यता समाप्त हो जाती। जहां तक ताल्लुक है नामांकन का, इस विषय पर बहुत लंबे अरसे से संविधान में, पार्लियामेंट में, पार्लियामेंटेरियन में चर्चा होती आई। आपको याद होगा श्री देव गौड़ा शायद जब बने हैं प्रधानमंत्री तो वो एमपी एमएलए नहीं थे। इंद्र कुमार गुजराल जब बने तो वो उसमें मेंबर थे लोग राज्यसभा के, ये इशू आता रहा है। मनमोहन सिंह जी भी जब प्राइम मिनिस्टर बने तो राज्यसभा के मेंबर थे। बहुत सारे लोगों का सुझाव है कि मुख्यमंत्री, प्रधानमंत्री और जो मंत्री हैं उनको चुने हुए, जनता से चुने हुए विधान परिषद, विधानसभा या लोकसभा का सदस्य होना चाहिए। जो इधर उधर से दूसरे दरवाजे से आते हैं उनके बारे में 2 राय हैं, कौन सी राय सही है कौन सी गलत है ये समय बताएगा, क्योंकि अभी इस पर कोई कंसेंसस नहीं हुआ। जहां तक राज्यपाल की शक्तियों का प्रश्न है, कुछ ऐसी चीजें हैं जो राज्यपाल सिर्फ एड एंड एडवाइज ऑफ द कैबिनेट पर कर सकता है। मंत्रियों की नियुक्ति है, उनके विभाग है, उनको बांटना है, विधानसभा को बुलाना है, विधानसभा का कितना सत्र होना है। लेकिन ये जो प्रश्न है नॉमिनेशन का विधान परिषद में, इसके संबंध में अभी कोई बहुत मेरी जानकारी के मुताबिक क्लियर गाइडलाइन नहीं है, क्योंकि एक लॉ जो पहले क्लैरिफाई कोर्ट्स कर चुकी है कि राज्यपाल जब किसी यूनिवर्सिटी के चांसलर की हैसियत में वाइस चांसलर, मेंबर्स ऑफ द एकेडमिक बोर्ड या एग्जीक्यूटिव कमेटी की नॉमिनेशन करते हैं तो वो स्वयं इंडिपेंडेंट निर्णय ले सकते हैं। राज्यपाल अगर किसी की क्रिमिनल केस में सजा माफ करना है तो राज्यपाल अपने विवेक से काउंसिल ऑफ मिनिस्टर्स की एडवाइस को इग्नोर करके भी अपने विवेक से निर्णय ले सकते हैं। इसलिए मुझे लग रहा है कि ये जो विषय है कि क्या राज्यपाल विधान परिषद में नॉमिनेशन के लिए जो सरकार है उसकी रिकमेंडेशन को मानने को बाध्य है या नहीं है, इस पर अभी आगे चर्चा होके कोई एक गाइडलाइन आनी चाहिए, फिर वो सबके लिए लागू होगी, चाहे महाराष्ट्र हो, चाहे पंजाब हो, चाहे आसाम हो। अभी तक इसके बारे में वैक्यूम है और मेरी अपनी निजी राय यह है कि राज्यपाल शायद बाउंड नहीं है इस विषय पर नॉमिनेशन के मामले में राज्य सरकार की रिकमेंडेशन को एक्सेप्ट करने में, क्योंकि नॉमिनेशन मेरिट के आधार पर होनी चाहिए, पॉलिटिकल आधार पर नहीं।
धन्यवाद सर, आपका बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया। आपने जिस तरह से ये
सर, जालिंदर सर, वन क्वेश्चन इज देयर इन केस ऑफ स्मॉल मार्जिन ऑफ वोट्स, दैट इज 1 और 2 वोट्स, इलेक्शन If anybody wins with one or two votes margin, whether the defendant candidate as a matter of right entitled to recount of votes.
See, when the when the counting takes place, at that time any candidate has the right to apply for recounting. This recounting application has to be given to the returning officer before the declaration of the result. And in the recount application, you have to state the grounds also. Simply sitter that margin is less in itself is no ground for recounting. And the election commission has also issued instructions if the difference between the two candidates is less than 1% of the total votes, then running officer cannot declare the result unless the election commission has granted its approval to that. So voting, you have a right to request for recounting of votes by giving reasons in the recount application, but it is the prerogative of the returning officer whether to accept that request or not to request that request. But he has to give reasons in the order as to why he is not going for the recount. In the election petition, simply sitter, the low margin is no ground for recounting. I can give you cases where the difference was only of one vote, two votes, three votes, five votes, seven votes. Still the courts did not order the recounting because there was no material facts in the election petition and there was no corroborative evidence that some mistake has been committed. It's not a matter of right. Discretion of the court.
Okay. Thank you, sir. When there is a breach of legal provisions by returning officer, in such cases, whether the election can be set aside?
Yes, yes. If the returning officer has violated any law, there are grounds given in section 100. For example, if some nomination has been illegally accepted or some nomination has been illegally rejected. So these are the two grounds for challenging the election. All those grounds are given in section 100 and 101. This is a ground to challenge the election of the returned candidate, even if the returned candidate is not guilty of anything. You go through one judgment, Rakesh versus Sunil Mehra, somewhere in 2004 or 2002. The returned candidate did not raise any objection to the petitioner. His nomination was rejected illegally by the returning officer. He filed the election petition. Supreme Court also set aside the election of the returned candidate, saying that, oh, it's good. It's okay. You did not raise any objection. You did not commit any mistake. But since the returning officer illegally rejected the nomination paper of a candidate, so the election will have to be held again.
Dhanyavad, sir. One Arvind Seth has raised hand.
Arvind, bolo.
1 minute.
Unmute him.
Yes. Arvind ji, aap apna ye okay.
Awaaz aa rahi?
Haan ji.
Haan, bolo.
Good evening, sir.
Yes, yes.
Arvind, bolo, bolo.
Sir, my question is, for how long a constituency can be kept reserved?
See, these are the issues to be decided by the on the recommendation of the Delimitation Commission and accepted by the Parliament. They have laid down the guidelines as to how the constituencies shall be reserved. They have laid down the percentage. There is a reservation of constituencies that the order is there. Guidelines have been laid down. So it has to follow that.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Hello.
I would like to invite.
Any other question? Any other question?
You, secretary. Sir, there is no question, I think, in chat box. And nobody has raised hand. So I think questions are finished, sir.
Okay.
May I take over, Sharadji?
Yes, yes.
सर आपने जो समय निकाला और लॉ ऑफ इलेक्शन पे इतना अच्छा तरह से सबको एड्रेस किया, इसके लिए नासिक बार एसोसिएशन की तरह से हम आपका बहुत ही आभार मानते हैं और शुक्रगुजार है। आपके जो ऑनर है, आपका जो रुतबा है वो बहुत ही बड़ा है, और इसलिए आपको सुन के हम सबको बहुत ही आनंद आया, इसमें कोई दो राय नहीं है। इसके बाद श्री धीरज जी भी यहाँ पे मौजूद है, मैं उनका भी आभार व्यक्त करता हूँ।
ये सारी तैयारी धीरज जैन ही करते हैं, सारी तैयारी वही करते हैं, वही देखते हैं सब।
धीरज जी ने बहुत सहयोग रहा, वो उसके बाद नीलकंठ जी है हमारे जो सहकारी है नासिक से, उन्होंने
कहा है वो नजर नहीं आ रहे, नितिन जी कहा है
नजर नहीं आ रहे, वही वही वही
अभी आए।
तो इन सभी, प्रीतपाल सिंह जी भी है, इन सभी का मैं आभार व्यक्त करता हूं। और आप सब यहां पे आए सर, आपने जो समय निकाला और सबको जो मार्गदर्शन किया वो अनमोल है, आपका भी हम बहुत आभार मानते हैं। और यहाँ पे जो मौजूद है श्रोतागण, उनका भी हम बहुत आभार मानते हैं, और आपको शुभकामनाएं, धन्यवाद धन्यवाद,
बहुत धन्यवाद, आप सबका भी बहुत धन्यवाद, आपने इतना मान सम्मान दिया, प्यार दिया, आपका बहुत धन्यवाद, नीलकांत का भी बहुत धन्यवाद, बाकी सबका जो ऑफिस,
नीलकांत सर और धीरज जी, नीलकांत सर और धीरज जी ने स्पेशली बहुत टाइम दिया, और नीलकांत सर जी उन्होंने जिन्होंने जिनके सहयोग से ये लेक्चर अरेंज हुआ है, उनका स्पेशली थैंक्स नीलकांत जी,
सारी बार का बहुत धन्यवाद,
थैंक यू वेरी मच,
बहुत धन्यवाद,
धन्यवाद सर, और प्रिविलेज, थैंक यू सर,
थैंक यू। वेबिनार या ठिकाणी संपन्न झालं असं मी नाशिक बारच्या वतीने जाहीर करतो, उद्याचं वेबिनार जे आहे त्या वेबिनारची लिंक आपणा सर्वांना पाठवली जाईल, धन्यवाद, जय हिंद, जय महाराष्ट्र।